Dufferin Construction Company is committed to our goal of zero harm. Our vision is that everyone will return home safely each day. Together, we can achieve zero harm through proper orientation and planning, best practices, using the right tools and equipment, which must be supported by teamwork and individual accountability. In addition to the Cardinal Rules and DCC New Employee Orientation, the grassroots team, through the Safety Culture Program, developed the DCC Railway Safety Orientation, which supports our zero harm vision. Recently, DCC has acquired multiple Metrolinx and CN contracts, which involve working near railway corridors. This type of work poses additional hazards that must be communicated and understood by all parties involved. The DCC Railway Safety Orientation outlines 1. General requirements. 2. On-track safety procedures and hazard assessments. 3. Emergency planning. 4. Reporting protocols. 5. Railway security awareness. 6. Environmental awareness. Training requirements. Required training consists of CN Contractor Orientation, offered online at contractororientation.com or in-house. Go CMO Contractor Orientation Program, offered by CMO and in-house. DCC Railway Safety Orientation Program. All outline training orientations must be completed in order to access the railway projects. If for any reason the training sessions are missed or applicants are unable to attend, a temporary visitor's permit must be issued, which will be valid for 48 hours only. The visitor is to be under supervision by a trained and competent individual who will be responsible for the untrained individual. Please note that the DCC Railway Safety Orientation is a general awareness review of the requirements, therefore does not supersede the mandatory CN Contractor Orientation and GO CMO Contractor Orientation. 1.2, Site-Specific Safety Program. This mandatory safety program is developed for each project prior to commencing work. It outlines the specific safety protocols and procedures to be used while working within the railway corridor. 1.3, Subcontractors. All contractors and subcontractors must comply with the site-specific safety program and all outlined safety protocols and procedures. This includes a detailed subcontractor compliance checklist to be completed and signed off by Dufferin Construction and subcontractor representative. 1.4, personal protective equipment. As a minimum, hard hats, safety glasses or side shields, reflective apparel, and 6 to 8 inch safety boots are required. Any additional PPE will be determined and discussed through the job-specific safety programs and work permits. 2.1, type of track protection. Rule 42 is a planned protection whereby the flagman, or EIC, is responsible for track protection within his Rule 42 limit. Trains are allowed to pass through the Rule 42 limits once given authority by the flagman. The Track Occupancy Permit, or TOP, is a form of positive protection provided by the flagman where trains may not enter the TOP limits without first communicating with the flagging foreman. Safety Watch is a form of protection where the flagman responsible for a specific work area advises the workers of approaching trains or high rail equipment. Depending on what work activity is being conducted, the railway authority will determine the type of protection required. 2.2, Morning Briefings. The morning briefing is a two-way communication between the flagman, who is the railway authority representative, and the contractors to discuss the following. The flagman will discuss working limits, types of communication, emergency procedures, potential hazards associated with working in the railway corridor, protocols when clearing trains. Contractors and subcontractors will discuss description of work activities and locations, expected deliveries, access and egress points to the railway corridor, type of equipment. the operators who will be running specified equipment. Note that the morning briefings are mandatory. They not only discuss the safety requirements in the railway corridor, but also assist in avoiding potential working conflicts between contractors. Workers may need to be briefed before entering the corridor, even though he or she was already briefed in the morning. If the access point to the corridor changes during operations, the workers need to be briefed again before entering the corridor. Emergency and evacuation points may change. New potential hazards may arise, and delays can cause sudden working conflicts. Therefore, workers must always check in with the flagman before entering the corridor and throughout the operation. If work should continue through to the next shift or nighttime, any briefings are still mandatory. 2.3, daily hazard assessment. In addition to the morning briefing, all contractors must conduct a daily hazard assessment, which outlines all potential hazards, and must also outline controls for the tasks being performed. 2.4, potential hazards within the railway corridor. Always be aware of approaching trains and high rail equipment. Train time is any time, on any track, in any direction. Look both ways when crossing, and do not use phones closer than 6 meters from the tracks. Any equipment operations within 5 meters of the tracks must stop when trains are approaching. Gatemen control all traffic at the gate, and flagmen control it at crossings. Pay close attention to any radio communications and keep all tools and materials outside of the track envelope when trains are approaching. Slips and trips can and do happen. Watch your footing and avoid stepping on rails when crossing. Be aware of chemical hazards. Countless shipments of hazardous materials are transported by trains daily. Extra caution is required. Public safety is of prime importance. Proper signage and protection is required to ensure public safety. Pedestrian access must be delineated from construction activity. Any work conducted overhead of public access areas require adequate hoarding and lighting. 2.5, other potential job hazards. Trenching and excavation. Permits must be issued before commencing any work. Utilities. Locate sheets need to be updated, kept in an organized file, and communicated to workers. The construction coordinator, foreman, and operators should discuss locate sheets prior to commencement of work. The method of excavation and exposing of utilities should be in accordance with utilities-owned company and TSSA requirements. Backing up. Complete any required permits and be aware of backup hazards and blind spots. Falls. Falls are the leading cause of fatalities in the construction industry. All fall hazards must be controlled through proper training and planning. The supervisor must complete a working at heights permit prior to commencing any work with the potential fall hazard. Hot work. Hot work permits must be issued and discussed with workers prior to work, and correct signage should be posted. Hoisting and rigging. Required permits need to be issued and discussed with workers. Tag lines must always be used, and any overhead power lines or obstructions need to be addressed. Communication is key, and operations are to be stopped when trains are approaching. Precautionary safe work procedures for major hoisting and rigging needs to be planned and communicated. Overhead power lines. OHPL exist on the majority of projects and can pose a significant danger to personnel working near them. A detailed OHPL hazard assessment must be completed and communicated when working in close proximity of power lines. Traffic hazards. The traffic protection and control plan needs to be completed and communicated with workers. The access and egress points for any closures need to be addressed, and pedestrian routes must be safely maintained. OPP and pay duty officers must be present when work is within 30 meters of any traffic light controlled intersection. Public safety is our main concern, and proper signage and hoarding is required when work is close to pedestrians. Night work. At times, night work is necessary to ensure work is completed in a timely manner. It is vital to ensure that adequate lighting is provided within the work area. In addition, when conducting work on nights, specific work plans are to be submitted and approved prior to commencing. Confined spaces. Confined space hazards must be adequately planned and assessed prior to entry. Requirements must be met and a confined space permit must be issued before commencing work. In order to adequately respond to any type of emergency, all personnel are reminded to ensure they are aware and knowledgeable of the site-specific emergency response protocols. In the railway projects, the emergency response plan is communicated every day in the briefing. It is important to know the access and egress for emergency crews. It is important to know the physical address of working area and method of communication in order to provide this vital information to emergency crew in emergency situation. The location of the nearest hospitals will be communicated to site personnel at briefings each day, along with the specific evacuation locations, first aid kit, and fire extinguisher locations. As one of the five cardinal rules, reporting all hazards, near misses, and incidents is a must and a condition of employment when working on Dufferin construction projects. Contractors must notify and consequently report any incidents or accidents as soon as they occur, not only to Dufferin Construction Company, but also to the railway authorities and CMO. The reporting protocol is determined in the site-specific safety plan and must be communicated to workers in their orientation program. Maintaining railway security is the responsibility of all personnel working within the railway. It is important to be aware of any suspicious activities and packages near the railway corridor and promptly report anything unusual to the immediate supervisor. Site personnel are reminded not to discuss any railway work activities with outside parties. Environmental awareness is one of the most vital requirements in construction. An environment response plan is developed and discussed with workers at the daily hazard assessment briefing. Public access areas should be kept clean during operations, and the discharged water to storm systems should be treated appropriately. If required, the groundwater level and degree of contamination needs to be measured daily and reported. As you can see, there are many additional hazards associated with working within the railway corridor. Dufferin Construction Company, a division of Holcim Canada, is committed to the health and safety of all employees partaking in any type of work within all the projects. We trust that by working together as a team and complying with the outlined procedures and regulations, we will accomplish our main goal of zero harm.